بسم الله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Welcome to tonight lesson. كتاب السنة, the book of Sunnah, and we'll go through the definitions of the Sunnah and the types of the Sunnah and how is the scholar record the Sunnah. So now we have these books of Sunnah. First, you have to know with one of the resources of the Tashri' of the ruling in Islam is the Sunnah. So we have Quran and Sunnah and Ijma' agreement, consensus. These are the main three sources of Tashri' or ruling in Islam. وَالسُنَّةِ in language means the style or the way. While in religion, it is the practice and the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in practicing the deen. And there are different definitions of the sunnah based on the subject of the Islamic study. So if we mention sunnah in fiqh, it differs than if we mention sunnah in hadith science, or even if we mention the word of sunnah in the way of da'wah or the way of reminding the people. Different if we say sunnah, it differs than if we say in fiqh, different than if we say in hadith. Also in aqidah, I believe also sunnah has names. So normally in fiqh, sunnah is one of the five main ahkam, rules. We have in Islam or fiqh, five ahkam, five rules. Wajib, haram, makruh, mubah, sunnah or mandub. So we have five. When you ask any mufti or any sheikh, he gives you, this is haram, this is wajib, this is makruh, this is mandub or sunnah, this is mubah. So sunnah in the fiqh point is called, means that something, if you did it, you will get reward. If you not do it, nothing for you. Yes, like when we pray five daily salah, it's compulsory, has a wajib, has a fard, compulsory. But the sunnah before or after, it is optional, but you get reward if you do it. So this in terms sunnah in fiqh. While sunnah in the hadith science, ilm al-hadith, it is five. Sunnah qawliya, the qawl of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the statement of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, saying of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sunnah fi'liya, the actions that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the Sahaba to do it, like prayer, how they practice prayer with him, that Hajj, this is sunnah fi'liya or action. And sunnah taqririyya means acceptance or taqrir or confirmation that something happened in the front of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he agreed on that. Like very simple example or very famous example, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the Sahaba to go toward Khaybar, to open Khaybar after Ghazwat al-Ahzab, after the trench or the delicate battle, qala la nusalliyanna al-asra fi bani Quraida. We will pray asr on bani Quraida. And then Sahaba differentiate in two groups. First one understood the meaning of this saying that it just motivate us to go quickly to open Khaybar, but we have to pray on time. And they pray on time. The other one take the sentence as it, and they delay the salah until they arrived. And when Prophet Muhammad sallam saw that from them, accept from them those as well as from those. That means that he accepts the action of that. And this is called sunnah taqririyya or acceptance sunnah. So we have qawliya, qawl, saying, fi'liya, fi'l, action, like prayer, like hajj. We have taqririyya, means that a Prophet accept something happen in front of him. Or sunnah khuluqiyya, خلق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. When you narrate his خلق, his أخلاق, his manners, his etiquettes, this is a sunnah as well. And sunnah خلقية, his خلق, his features, how looks like, how we try to copy him, his long beard and wearing imama, whatever, all this kind of sunnah of his shape, how his looks like. So this is the five types of sunnah in علم الحديث. In wa'z, in reminder, when you remind the people, sunnah more likely goes with the thing which opposite to innovation or bid'ah, that something which not belongs to the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sunnah is opposite that. So when you say this is not from sunnah to pray like that, means the style of your ibadah have to be according to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also sunnah in the aqidah or belief means belief. So previously the old or the recent scholar, or sorry, the previous scholar in the early time, they called the belief sunnah. And you can see most of the books that has been wrote on this time, usul sunnah, the foundation of sunnah, which is aqidah book. Sharh al-Sunnah, explanation of Sunnah, which is Aqidah book or belief book. So previously, Sunnah could be related to the belief concept. Right. Let us start, go through the history of recording the Sunnah. And before we go to the history of recording of Sunnah, I think I mentioned the recording of the Quran. How is the Quran? I don't think so, I've mentioned that. But anyway, I repeat again. So Quran has been recorded individually by every Sahabi in his own recording, whatever they have, like a sheet from the bone, sheet from the leaf of palm tree, sheet from skins. Every Sahabi learned from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam his Quran, he recorded in his sheet. And but there is no specific or one book having all this Quran in one. After, as you know, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away on the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq. There is a battle happened called Al-Yamama. This battle, 70 Hafiz has been murdered in this battle. And Umar al-Khattab was worried about the Quran and how can we keep the Quran. And this Hufaz has been died, 70 Hafiz, big number. And then he discussed that with Abu Bakr. And by several conversation, Abu Bakr agreed that he collect all the Quran in one Mus'haf. And he nominated Zayd ibn Thabit al-Ansari, a youth, he's about 23 years old. He's a hafiz, he's a katib al-wahi, wahi writer. And he collected the Quran from all the sheets that there. And he set a condition, everyone have to bring two witnesses that he hear this surah or this verse from the Prophet Muhammad sallam face to face. And he collect all the surahs and all of the Sahaba memorized the surahs already, so they now aware about what inside this book. And this book kept with Hafsa, the Umm al-Mu'mineen, the daughter of Umar al-Khattab and the wife of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, till the Khilafah of Uthman. In the time of Uthman, there is a expansion of the Futuhat, expansion of the battles everywhere, and it comes now. There a dispute happened between several Muslims from different countries, different places. Because several Sahaba left their place toward different countries and teach the people the way that they learned from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And now comes everyone have dispute with the other, because this is not the way I taught, has been taught by the Sahaba, and this is another way, and start to fight. And then Huzayfa ibn al-Yaman came to Uthman ibn Affan and told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, save the people before they start to fight on their book like the Christian and the Yahud fight in the book. And then he nominate four people, one of them Zayd ibn Thabit again, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and Abdurrahman ibn Harith. All these three of them is from Quraysh, and only one from Al-Madinah, which is Zayd ibn Thabit. And then he said to them, if you have a different way of reading, keep it on the slang or the language or the accent of Quraysh, because the Quran revealed to Quraysh according to their accent. And they gathered all that and agreed about the Qira'at according to the accent of Quraysh. And he copied several copies of the Mus'haf and sent it everywhere of the countries. This is the story of the Mus'haf that we have now. For the Sunnah, is quite different.
Can I interrupt? So the sequence of Quran, you see, there's a certain surahs they are Makki and certain they are Madni. So that's how it revealed, or
okay. So the sequence, it is tawqifi, means Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi said to Sahaba, this surah should be comes after surah and this after surah. So the sequence from Prophet by revelation. Type Makki or Madani, it is opinions of the Mufassirin. Depends on the narration. So there is no agreement between the scholar about this Makki, this Madani, but the sequence is from revelation. Prophet Muhammad sallam, keep it, as has been revealed from Allah. Yeah. Then the Sunnah. How is the Sunnah recorded? First, at the beginning, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, it has been narrated, said to in Hadith Abi Sa'id Khudri, لا تكتبوا عني ومن كتب عني غير القرآن فليمحيه. So don't write anything of my saying, and anyone who wrote, he has to erase it. At the beginning, and the reason of that, still the Quran is still going on. Still, revelation is going on, and still the Muslim didn't know the difference between the language of the Quran and the language of the Hadith. So maybe some mixing or misunderstanding of that. Because of that, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Don't write anything." Then later on, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As كان يكتب everything. He used to write everything of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, and then his tribe Quraysh. And this shows that it's happened after the opening of Quraysh, because Quraysh, before that, she wasn't Muslim, and then they accept Islam on 8th of Hijrah. When they start to write everything of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they told him, his tribe, why you write everything from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And he's a human. You write him in the in anger or in happy. And then he went to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said to him that. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam pointed to his tongue, and he said, by Allah, by the one with my soul in his hand, it never comes a thing from my mouth except the truth. That means that he never say something wrong. So, and then he asked him to write. So every Sahabi wrote the hadith in his own sheet as well. This was a randomly recording of the Sahaba of the hadith. But actually, when the Sunnah has been gathered, has been collected. Actually, on the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Khalifa in Amawi state. As you know, we have five Khulafa Rashidin. Five, okay? First, Abu Bakr, 2 years and approximate half. Then, Umar al-Khattab, 10 years. And then, Uthman ibn Affan, another 10 years. And then, Ali ibn Abi Talib, about 5 years. And then overall is about 29 and a half years. And Hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that there will be after the Prophet period will be Khilafah on the way of Prophet. And this Khilafah, according to Hadith, is 30 years. So there are 6 months left in these 30 years. Then after Ali ibn Abi Talib, his son Al-Hasan ibn Ali came as a Khalifa for 6 months, and then he resigned to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu to avoid fighting together. And because of that, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this my son about Al-Hasan, he's a master, as a Sayyid. And Allah will make him a reason to stop fighting between the Muslim or to conceal between the Muslim. So this is 30 years of Khilafah, 5 years. Then we have a gap after Al-Hasan was about 40 of Hijrah. 41 of Hijrah, came some ruler from Bani Umayyah, like Muawiyah ibn, Abi Sufyan, 20 years. And then a dispute happened between Yazid and Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Abdullah Zubayr is a son of Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and Asma bint Abi Bakr. They have two separate khilafah. The first khilafah, which contains the majority of the countries, Mecca, Medina, and Hijaz all, and Egypt, and also Iraq. All the country was under the ruling of Abdullah ibn Zubayr for nine years. On the other hand, only Al-Sham, which is currently now Syria and Jordan, is under the ruling of Bani Umayyah. All of that ended with the Khalifa of عمر بن عبد العزيز in 99 هجرة. So this was Khalifa, they called him Amir al-Mu'mineen or the fifth Khalifa of Rashidin. They ignoring the counting of the Hassan ibn Ali, and they add him also as a Khulafa al-Rashidin because he was a just ruler, and he was the one who initiate collection and recording of Sunnah Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, in his time, there are different scholars of hadith. And then he wrote to them to go and collect the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from all the Sahaba there. There are about 70 Sahabi attend Badr, have their own hadith. Also Abu Huraira, the one who narrated about 5,630 hadith, is still there. And Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As has own recording as well. So still the Sahaba is there, most of them. So the scholar this time, one of them is a very famous scholar. His name is Ibn Ma'in. Yahya ibn Ma'in is one of the great scholar who was responsible for collection of this sunnah in one book. And later on, Al-Bukhari came. He was student of the scholars of Zuhri. Zuhri is the one who collected the old hadith in one book. And then Al-Bukhari came, and then Muslim, and then we have Abi Dawood, we have, and then Al-Tirmidhi, and then we have Al-Nasa'i, and then we have Imam Malik, we have Imam Ahmad Musnad, and we have Ad-Darami. This is a very famous eight, and Ibn Majah before those. So there are eight very famous hadith books. They already collected the hadith from Az-Zuhri, who collected the hadith in one book. And then Al-Bukhari wrote his Sahih, and Muslim his Sahih, and Al-Tirmidhi as well, and Al-Nasa'i, and Abi Dawood, and Al-Tirmidhi, and Ibn Majah, and Imam Malik, and also Ad-Darami. So this is so far the history of collection of the Sunnah according to the books, as you can see. There are some books came after that, after Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari and all of that, like very famous books, Riyadh al-Salihin. Everyone know Riyadh al-Salihin. Riyadh al-Salihin, how it works, how the author of Riyadh al-Salihin wrote his book, Imam al-Nawawi. Actually, he select a hadith about 1400 hadiths from Bukhari, from Muslim, from Abi Dawood, from Nasa'i, and he selected and put in the chapters. Chapter of Tawbah, chapter of Sabr, chapter of Salah, Fada'il al-A'mal, all this kind, put it in the chapters, and he select, it is not a specific hadith book, he collection of a hadith. So he didn't narrate this hadith by himself. While for Bukhari, he hears a hadith from his shuykh and he wrote it in a book. Muslim the same. Here's a hadith from the shuykh and narrated in his book. All those have been narrated the hadith from their shuykh. But Imam Nawawi, no. Imam Nawawi, he just select from the Bukhari, from Muslim, and put it in one chapter. So this is the way of al-Bukhari. Also, there is a 40 Nawawi hadith, as you know, heard about it. What is the story of 40 Nawawi? By also Imam Nawawi. SubhanAllah, Imam Nawawi, although he, يعني, he died while he was less than 40 years old. But if you look to his books, his publishing books, mashallah, amazing, and a benefit from it a lot. He wrote in fiqh, in hadith, in adab al-Quran, يعني, a great يعني, job he did. May Allah bless him and forgive him and forgive everyone. So this is 40 Nawawi, the story of 40 Nawawi. Initially, every scholar of hadith tried to gather 40 hadiths which cover all the deen. This start by initially one scholar, his name Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and then Ibn Salah, he collect 26 hadiths. Then Imam Nawawi built on these 26 hadiths. he took this 26 hadith and add to become 42 hadiths. It's actually 42, not 40. So these 42 hadiths cover all the branches of the deen. It cover the belief, cover some of the mu'amalat, relation, cover of some of the akhlaq, some of the rules that you have to follow. So, and then after Imam al-Nawi, another half is his name, Ibn Rajab, came and add extra 8. So overall 50. And the scholar calls this 50 Jawami' al-Kalim, the comprehensive saying of Prophet. That's the theory that I'm giving after Isha every night. Is from the 50 hadith that have been collected by Ibn Salah, 26. Imam Nawawi completed to 42. Hafiz Ibn Rajab completed to 50. This is called 50 hadith Jawami' al-Kalim, the comprehensive saying of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, what is our responsibility toward the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Inshallah, I will go in details tomorrow in the khutbah, inshallah, about what is our responsibility towards the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, in order to say I'm following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have to show the evidence. The evidence of following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first, al-iktimaru bima amar. So to follow his command. وَالْإِنْتِهَاءُ عَمَّا زَجَرْ and stay away from his prohibition. If he forbids something, don't do it. وَالْإِقْتِدَاءُ بِسُنَّتِهِ and copy his sunnah, his akhlaq, his manners, his style. وَإِفْ you hear his name, say صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Other than that, you are not following Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. How is you following Prophet Muhammad sallam and he asked you to do something and he didn't do it. He asked you to stop doing something and you do it. So if you want to be a follower of Prophet Muhammad sallam, you have to show the evidence. And the great thing that you can know the sunnah of Nabi sallam is the sahaba. So if you don't know the sunnah from sahaba, from whom you will know? The sahaba is so close to Prophet Muhammad sallam and they didn't left any thing that he did in every part of the life. And they so keen to transmit it as it without any addition or any removing. So you have to know about the Sahaba. Know about the Sahaba and trust in their honesty. And try to know how they struggle with learning, how they struggle with transmitting the knowledge, and how they seek the knowledge to have these books with us. To have the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with us. And by the way, ilm al-hadith, the hadith science is very, very academic. I can say academic because if you compare the principle of hadith terminology with the standard in the university, it exceeded. Wallahi exceeded. Because in the standard in the university, they didn't set this condition that like we have in hadith. How is this condition? I tell you the condition and will you agree with me. In order to accept the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it has to fulfill 5 conditions. First one, continuation of the narrator's chain. The narrators who narrate the hadith from Prophet start with his companions, end with the author of the book, for example, Bukhari. So between Bukhari and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a narrators. It has to be connected, no gap between them. So if you have a gap in any point of this narration chain, this hadith is rejected immediately. Da'if, weak. The first condition, it has to be continuous chain of narrators. Then every narrator has to be fulfill this condition. It has to be honest, trustful. Do not lie. All this condition has to be fulfilled. And how do you know that? They wrote a book which identify every narrators of hadith Nabi sallam by judging on his manners, in his akhlaq, in his hifz, in his behavior. How is the people talk about him? And this very very big books is called the books of the men, ilm al-rijal. They wrote all the narrators' name according to alphabetical order. For example, if you want to know, narrator starts with Alif. You go to the Aleph section in the in this book and check all the Aleph names, and then you will see what they said about him, about his honesty, about his that. So every narrators have this يعني list of opinions. So it has to pass this list. It has to be honest. Third condition after continuation of the narration chain has to be honest and trustful. Third one, it has to be controlling his memorization or his transmitting of the hadith. How he transmits the hadith? Is that by heart? He memorizes the heart. So if it by heart, how is his memorization? Strong memorization or short memorization? And this also will be judged by the shuyukh who teach him and who taught him and such and such. So if he is strong memorizing and he control, he hafiz, like he hafiz the hadith like hafiz al-Quran. So like the Quran half by heart, he memorized the hadith by heart. There's no mistake. And he can read the hadith exactly. Or he can record. So he may either narrate the hadith by heart or by recording. And even he recorded, does he control this record? Means that he put his book that he recorded, like his book, for example. Did I leave it everywhere so one can change it, or did I keep it in my pocket or safe? This also we consider. So this is third condition. Then the fourth condition, these narrators narrate this hadith like the similar narrators or different. Like, for example, we're sitting here together, maybe 10 people. After the lesson, 9 of you will told their friend, we have lesson explaining the sunnah. And one said, we have a lesson in salah. Then the one who said in salah said something odd, which we accepted or not accepted. The 9 agreed that we have lesson in sunnah. And only one said, no, it is lesson in salah. So we reject this narration who has an odd narrators who odd to the others. So they do that. So they collect all the narration from different narrators and check if they agreed together or any oddness or any change. If there is oddness, they reject the oddness. And also the fifth one, which is very, very sensitive or very specific. Not anyone knows that, only the scholar of the hadith. I give you an example. My name, for example, Ahmad Mustafa, okay? And then I give talk here in Sydney, plus. And then one of your friends living in Perth, plus. And you went and you called him, okay, I have lesson from Ahmad Mustafa, I say such and such. And then this person in Perth went to some place and said, I hear the Ahmad Mustafa say such and such. Is that correct? He heard me? Or there is someone between me and him, he heard and he told him. But if the case like that, you reject this narration. Because you don't know, he maybe didn't narrate the correct narration. So who knows that? Only the scholar of the hadith. Who will check? Is this person in Perth met with Ahmad Mustafa in Sydney before? Or who attended here or no? How do you know? By history. They have history for each narrator, where he born, where he lived, where he went with. It's a very specific science. So after all of that, okay, this sahih, this da'if, weak. It's not easy job. You can't find in any academic university like that. This kind of restriction in order to make sure that the sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is secured and also safe from any fabrication, the scholar of ilm al-hadith put these five conditions. Continuation of a chain of narration, no gap between the narrators. If any gap, this hadith rejected. Second, all the narrators has to be trustful and honest. And by the way, all the sahaba or the companion are udul, are trustful. Don't say sahabi, I have to check. No, you have to believe the sahabi is honest. This is aqidah, believe. Also, after you check the honesty of the narrators, then you check how they narrate this hadith. Did they narrate the hadith by their heart? Type. If they by their heart, if they are strong memorizing hadith or they have short memorization, who told you? It's their shuyukh, the people around them. If there is a hafiz al Quran and he said, I'm hafiz al Quran, you go ask his sheikh, what about his hifz? He said, correct, khalas, I will accept his hifz. And such as, or he's just controlling the narration by writing in a book, but please he secures his book or leave it everywhere, someone can change it. And then not only that, if his narration is similar to the other majority of the narrator, or he is doing something odd. And the last one, which is if he actually met with the sheikh or just heard it through someone else. All this, it's not easy job. It has to be done by the scholar and judge on the hadith, is it sahih or da'if, and then protect the sunnah from any kind of fabrication. And because of that, because if you take the hadith da'if and you establish a rule, it's wrong. You have to build your rule based on hadith sahih. And because of that, the scholar of the hadith set this kind of condition to make sure that we have a hadith sahih, a correct hadith that we can rely on it. Because in terms of fatwa, you have to deal with hadith sahih only. Fadail A'mal, righteous deed, some scholar said you can use the hadith of da'if to some fadail A'mal, like some ibadah, which is like night laka, halal or haram, like ruling of sharia. But sometimes, for example, some of the azkar which maybe has da'af, but some people, some scholars say we can use this azkar just as a righteous deed, but with condition. Not first, it has to be a reference or connection or link with other source sahih, means that there is a hadith sahih or the verse in the Quran saying something similar, so I can use something like that. And also, it should not be very weak. It's not from one who lie, because Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said من تعمد أو من كذب علي متعمدا فليلج النار. Whoever tells lies against me, he will be in the hellfire. So if anyone tell lies intentionally and fabricate the hadith, the great problem. So in this case, you have to make sure that this hadith, if you want to use it for fada'il a'mal, it shouldn't be a very weak hadith. Also, it should be have a link between this meaning of the hadith and hadith sahih or a verse in the Quran. Also, it should be, you should believe it is not sahih, but just know it is da'if, but I'm just, because it's not a very weak hadith and has link to other verse in Quran or hadith sahih, I'm doing that. And also, you should have no relation to the ahkam, the rules. Don't make it in halal haram, just only for kind of ibadah, but not for halal haram. By this way, you can use the hadith of da'if with this condition. But if you ask my opinion, I found, and my shaykh told me, there is no need of using hadith da'if even in fada'il a'mal, because we have more than enough in hadith sahiha using for the ibadat and mu'amalat. But just I'm saying the opinion of some of the scholars, they're using this hadith da'if based on this opinion. But if you ask my opinion, my shaykh told me no need to use da'if since you have hadith sahih. هذا والله أعلم. So we stop with that. As we explain tonight, we explain the difference between the sunnah in fiqh. What's the meaning of sunnah in fiqh? Something, you will not get sins if you leave it, and you get reward if you do it. Sunnah. And sunnah in hadith, what's the mean? Speech of Prophet? فعلية, action? تقريرية, yes. And خلق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, and خلق النبي, his shape, his features. And we explain how the sunnah has been collected or gathered, especially in the time of who's the Khalifa names? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And he gave that to a scholar called Az-Zuhri. And then from this series, Al-Bukhari narrate his books, Muslim, his books, Abi Dawood, his books, Al-Nasa'i, his book, Ibn Majah, Al-Tirmidhi, Musnad Imam Ahmad, Muwatta Imam Malik, Musnad Darami, all these nine famous hadith book. And what is different between these books and Riyadus Salihin, for example? Who can tell me? Yes, we're saying just collection from this part of books in one book. And what's the story of 14 hours? Who can tell me the story of 14 hours? Okay, it started first by 26 hadith by Ibn Salah, and then Imam Nawawi came and added to become 42. And then who's Ibn Rajab Ahsant added 8 to become 50 hadith. This is called Jawami al-Kalim, or the comprehensive saying of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which combine all the needs in deen. And this is the one we're talking every night after Isha, Jawami al-Kalim, these 50 hadith. Very important hadith for the beginners who want to seek the knowledge. this 50 hadith, learn it. If you can memorizing in Arabic, it's okay. If you just understanding and learning, it's very important and very beneficial. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر لكم. So tonight is the last night lesson, inshallah. Still have tonight after Isha, inshallah. Inshallah, and tomorrow morning after Fajr, and then Jum'ah second session, inshallah. And then I will leave, inshallah. بارك الله فيكم. Any question? طيب. Start with 40 nows. 40 nows, I said, and the addition of Ibn Rajab is 50 hadith. This is the basic start with that. You learn from that the basic and the principle of Sunnah Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you want to know more, Riyadh al-Salihin also very good. But start with a simple one, which is 50 hadith is enough. If you have more time and more, but my advice is to read it from Sheikh. Don't read by yourself. Because sometimes you maybe misunderstood the meaning or understood the translation or the sharh. And sometimes, by the way, the 40 now is not all sahih. So some of them have some da'if. So we have to also to know which is sahih, which is da'if. So we have to be with Sheikh. Okay. Barakallahu fiikum. Jazakum Allah khayran. Assalamu alaikum.